today we are going to talk about blending when oil painting. Now, I feel like this is a little bit of a controversial topic, and many times throughout my life when I was young and even when I was studying in academies and ateliers, people often told me that I shouldn't blend and that blending was bad, it would destroy your form, muddy your color, or that it was lazy and kind of a shortcut. And in fact, in recent times, I've perused YouTube and I found entire videos dedicated to telling you that you shouldn't blend, you should never blend, it's bad, it'll make you a worse person. And I'm here to say, maybe. I kind of see the point in certain circumstances, but at the same time, I blend. I blend all the time, and I'm proud of it. I'm not gonna succumb to the blend shaming that is rife in our society. I don't know. I like to blend. I blend all the time. My process incorporates blending as one of its main key components, but I also see that there are certain problems with blending and certain concerns you need to be mindful of so that you can offset them or work around them and use blending in your process in a way that's effective and doesn't make your painting worse. So I don't really know how to structure this video. I don't write a script or plan these out or do any research. I just hit record and I start talking. So let's see if we can make some sense out of this topic. First, I think it's important for me to share with you how I blend, the steps I follow, and how it fits into my oil painting process. And then that way we can talk about the concerns in the context of how it is I blend when painting. Now again, I blend all the time. Any painting you see me do in any of the videos here on YouTube, on my Patreon, on my website, my feature length tutorials, I'm blending through most forms, but I do it in a very particular, specific way. To help me show you how it is I blend when I do my portraits, let me share with you a few painting exercises. Here I'm painting a grisaille monochromatic value scale. Here you can see me lay down values in individual areas or brush strokes. Now, one key feature here is that each brush stroke overlaps the previous, but it's more like the shingles of a roof where you have one shingle overlap the next. And that little overlap area is key to how I blend when painting. Now you'll notice that I individually mixed up 6 to 7 values here to create this value scale. Again, they each overlapped, and once they're all in, I can begin to blend. Now the way I blend is, I take my brush, I wipe it clean on a paper towel, and I discreetly blend in that area where 2 brush strokes or 2 values overlap. I don't broadly blend the whole thing. I don't take a fan brush. I don't blend wholesale. I blend in small discrete areas, again, where those brush strokes overlap. And I'm constantly wiping my brush clean and blending that little small area. Here you can see me applying the same technique of blending when painting an actual form. Here I'm painting a sphere from imagination, and I'm working one piece of paint after the other, tiling them subtly so that they overlap, and then after I get a series of brush strokes in, I can go in and discreetly blend, wiping my brush clean so that I'm only blending in that small little area where those 2 pieces of paint overlap. And here I'm applying that same thought process to painting in color. I'm going along this imagined flesh tone, each brush stroke overlapping the next, each value and color individually mixed, and in that overlapping zone, that area where they are sort of shingled together, I can then discreetly go back in and blend those 2 little areas, again wiping my brush clean with a paper towel. Now, these exercises, which I originally made for my Patreon audience, really helped me isolate that blending practice. And it's a really great thing for you to isolate and practice if you're new to blending or you want to perfect that as a particular component to your overall process. But whenever you see me paint full portraits, I could be painting a forehead, a cheek, a nose, wherever it is, I'm always blending. And I'm essentially blending as I go. I'm mixing out as many individual colors as I can. I make sure they overlap. And then I go in and I discreetly blend those together so that I can keep the whole thing continuous as I paint. So now that you know my basic approach to blending and how it fits into my process, let's talk about some of the concerns I've heard over the years about blending. One of the big concerns is that it can create generalized or very generic form, and that's absolutely true. If you were to mix a color and put it here at the top of the cheek and then mix another color and put it down here and blend that together, you would have a very generic gradation. That would be the same as painting a sphere where you just plop down a value at the top of the sphere and then a value down by the shadow and blur them together. That sphere gradates in a very particular way that is related to the nature of the light source, how far that light source is away, the size of that light source. So if you were to paint it in that way to where you just blend two colors together, you're going to end up with very generic results that don't sensitively portray the light effect in your scene. And that only gets worse when you're painting more complex things like a portrait. So you really want to avoid that. And you can see in my exercise what I laid out and how I described my own blending process. I individually mixed as many pieces of paint as possible, and I would do the same thing across a cheek, a forehead, a nose, or any other form so that I don't end up with that generic form. I want my paint and I want the mixtures to respond to structural changes so I can convey a zygomatic bone, the masseter, the nasolabial fold, any other structure in a very profound and meaningful way. So you want to individually mix as much paint and as many color shifts and structures as you can, and then blend those things together after you've realized the fullness of that structure and form. Another big concern is that you can flatten out your form and lose your form altogether when you blend. And that's absolutely true. If you blend way too late in the process and you blend over a broad area, you can very much flatten out and lose that sense of form, that illusion of space. And so what I try to do is exactly what you see in those little demonstrations earlier in the video. I try to blend in little discrete areas where two pieces of paint overlap so that that blending happens in a very controlled manner and not broadly over a large area. And something else I try to do is really summon that illusion of form that I'm always talking about. I always talk about inhabiting that three-dimensional space, pretending you're sculpting, and you really want to think about that more than ever when you're blending, because the temptation can be to start to superficially smooth that paint out on the canvas so it looks nice and slick and pristine. And when you do that, and when you get too lured into that outcome, you can sometimes forget to think about that three-dimensional form. So make sure you adhere your mind to that three-dimensional illusion as you blend, and try to blend in small little discrete areas where that paint overlaps in a very controlled manner, and avoid blending over very large areas, because then you will soften it and lose that sense of form. Now, one of the other things that can really happen when you blend, and it's very much related to these other issues, is you can muddy your color. So color changes in relationship to the light source, in relationship to local color changes on the surface of your material. And those are very specific changes. The chroma might go down with the value as that light drops off. Light might pass through a translucent form and the chroma goes up just near that terminator as the light runs tangent. You might have reflected light bouncing in. You could have any number of things, and you see these throughout all of my portrait paintings where I respond to all these chroma shifts and all these hue shifts that are associated with maybe redder cheeks, redder noses, more yellow forehead, whatever the case might be. And these are all individually conceived in a very conceptual and observational way. And when you blend, and you blend over too broad of an area, you can completely dilute that color effect or those color relationships that you worked so hard to achieve. So again, you don't want to blend over too large of an area, and you want to be very mindful of what you're blending and how in a very controlled manner to avoid smearing out the chroma that you worked so hard to achieve, or that delicate balance of hue. So again, blend in small discrete ways, stay on the form, and don't blend broadly over a large area. If you blend as you go, after maybe 5, 6, 7 individual brush strokes, and keep that sort of built into your process, you can avoid that pitfall of later on smearing everything out, and you can have a smooth surface in a way that is integrated into your overall painting process. So don't be afraid of blending. Blending is your friend. Thank you for checking out this video. If you like my content, make sure you hit that subscribe button. Check me out at patreon.com/ScottWaddell, and check out my website where you can see feature-length art tutorials at scottwaddellfineart.com. I think my eyebrow